Bring it back. From the End Groove Remains production team studios in the Netherlands. My name is Mixmaster G and welcome to this live stream. My mission is not to sell you as many apps as I can. No, my mission is to educate and teach you about collection management and conversion for DJs so you save yourself more time for the fun and creative part of being a DJ. It is 2022, my friends. So happy 2022 for every one of you. I hope you had a great new year. I hope you had great holidays with friends and family. But now the real world is opening up again. And let's hope that we can put Corona a little bit behind us after this Omicron variant. Because it seems that in a normal virus evolution, there is expected to be a virus that is highly contagious and less sick-making. And after that, it just teeters down. And that is exactly what is happening. So let's hope that will happen with Corona as well. Because we are all longing for real good gigs. And not that up and down, closed and open again, all over the place. Before I start the show, let's say hi to some of the regulars in the chat already. AG Flow, all the best to you, my friend. Good to see you. Good to see you. Eddie Brome, good evening. Salute. And Vulcan G, happy new year, my friend. Good to see you too. For those of you who are unfamiliar with me, a quick introduction. I am a 55-year-old dude from the Netherlands. I had my first DJ residency at the age of 15. That means you look at almost 40 years of DJ experience in the flesh. And I like to share the knowledge that I accumulated over those years with you guys. And that is why I do these streams. My streams are a little bit different than other Ask Me Anything streams because I try not only to tell you how you can do certain things, but also to demonstrate how to do them. That also means that this show is on the geeky side of the spectrum. Things can get real geeky indeed. If that is the case, just slow me down in the chat because my only reason why I'm doing these shows is to just spread the knowledge. And that means that if I'm going too fast because I take certain things for granted, then just slow me down and just ask me. I do this show each Tuesday, 7 o'clock p.m. Central European Time. If you cannot make it live to the show, then you can always ask me your questions in an email or on Facebook through Facebook Messenger or in the comments right below the video. And I'll be happy to answer them in the next stream. For this week, I have basically two things that I want to discuss with you. There is not much news because everything was closed down due to the new year. So the only thing that I want to discuss is, first of all, a very curious bug on the Apple new PowerBook M1 16-inch computers and only those computers. And I'm going to show you what the bug is, how it works, etc. I don't have PowerBook 16-inch M1 myself, but I can just show you what the problem is. And then let's hope that Apple will fix it. The other thing I'm going to show you is how the new Rekordbox Q and Key tool, that is my tool that I've written to integrate mixed key data with Rekordbox, and especially a Rekordbox 6 collection, how that tool is now fully aware of Dropbox and CloudSync within the Pioneer DJ ecosystem. And that gives you some very, very nice opportunities. But this stream is open for each and every question. So if you have your particular question, just drop it in the chat. Don't forget to say hi first. And then I'm happy to address that question in the Ask Me Anything or in the Q&A section of the Ask Me Anything. For now, let's dive into the first issue of today. And that issue is a really strange one. If you happen to have a brand new PowerBook 16-inch M1, so the PowerBooks that were introduced last October, those PowerBooks and only those PowerBooks have a bug. And that bug is affecting the apps that I write. I write all my apps in AppleScript as a container, and I do that with a purpose because AppleScript, for the almost 30 years that I'm using Apple computers, even back from the Motorola days to the RISC days, to the Intel days, to the M1 days, AppleScript did never change. Apple kept AppleScript roughly the way it is right now, which is the reason why I chose AppleScript as the container for all my apps, because that saves me development time. Whatever Apple will do, my stuff continues to work on it, basically because it was written in, or the container was written in AppleScript. So with that in mind, I chose AppleScript as the container. Now, as everybody knows, the M1 computers work in two different moduses. They work either in the binary M1 modus, that means you take full advantage of the speed that the M1 processor is bringing you, or it works through Rosetta. And Rosetta is a real-time emulator environment Apple wrote, and Rosetta basically emulates an Intel processor Mac. Deep inside, my apps want to be through the Rosetta emulator for this moment. And I hear it say, hey, Mixmaster D, that means they are slow. They are not really that slow. But the reason for that is I want my apps to work on every Mac out there. I've got DJs working on High Sierra, a lot of DJs working on High Sierra, on Catalina, on Mojave, on Big Sur. And that means that I don't want to restrict myself to a binary that only works on M1 and is optimized for M1. So that is why I want Rosetta to be the way to go. Now, first, let me show you on my M1 Mini what this means. And then I'm going to show you how you can emulate the bug yourself. Let me log into my Mac Mini. And then I shouldn't forget to switch the screens, because I sometimes tend to do that. As you can see, this is my Mac Mini. You can see it is running macOS Monterey version 12.1. That was another thing. The first time a user reported this problem, this particular problem I'm going to show you, to me, he told me, Mixmaster G, your apps don't work on 12.1. They work perfectly on 12.1. It turns out this problem is not a 12.1 problem. It is a MacBook 16-inch M1 problem only. I made a very simple script, as you can see right here, test one. And if you look inside that script, then you can, if you have a 16-inch MacBook Pro, you can do it yourself. You can see it is, all it says is display dialog and then hello between asterisks. That means that if you run it, you see hello and that's it. Now, if you look at this app and I command I it, you see it is not running through Rosetta. It is basically running in the binary environment because I wrote it on that M1. Now, if I double click it, as expected, open it up, do it, the hello box appears. That is exactly what you expect. Now, the fun part is, if I say open using Rosetta, it will open too. Now, if you are on a MacBook Pro 16-inch M1, the ones that were recently introduced, October 2021, this will not work. If you have the check or open using Rosetta Box enabled, and you try to run the script, it does do nothing. That indicates that there is a bug in the particular version or something that is happening in an MacBook, in a MacBook 16-inch Pro that is different from what is usually happening at M1 computers with 12.1. So there is a distinction there, and I deem it a bug. I've contacted Apple. I have given them all the documentation they require for an official bug report, and I hope they will fix it. Effectively, this means that my tools, and none of my tools, works on the brand new PowerBook 16-inch PowerBook Pro 16-inch that were introduced in October. On everything else, it's fine on 12.1. It's fine. All apps run fine on 12.1. But that particular Mac model gives you problems. And to be honest, that is the first time in my whole history, in my whole career using Apple stuff, that there is a particular model that is acting differently from all the other models. And why, I don't know. But hey, that is Apple's thing to fix. I just wanted to point it out because it is important. I see Alan Cross with a very big question. Alan, I will dive into that. Well, why not straight away? Let's see what you have to say, my friend. I am attempting to transfer my music collection Rekordbox 5 from one machine to an M1 MacBook Pro running macOS Monterey. The music collection is on an external hard drive. Now, when I have done this before transferring my music collection, it has always given me an option to where I want to unzip and store the music collection, as I have another spare external hard drive ready plugged in, ready to go. However, for whatever reason, it doesn't seem to give me the option any longer and automatically unzips the collection and imports it into my internal SSD drive, which is too small for the collection. Any thoughts, please? Alan. First of all, how are you transferring? Are you transferring using the Rekordbox built-in backup procedure? Let me show how that looks like. M1 off. We're going to need that later on. Let me fire up Rekordbox. And then what you always can do is say, and let's see where that is at, a library, backup library, and then you've got the option to backup, including the audio tracks. You can say backup library. This is just a very small one. You want to backup? Yes, I want to backup. And then it goes, and then it creates a zip file. I am not a fan of this procedure at all. The reason for that is that it is simply too slow and too bulky. And as you have found out yourself, if you are extracting, then you have the risk that it extracts on your internal drive. Stuff doesn't fit in, things like that. So I don't like to do that. Yeah, all right. That's what I'm afraid of. You use the built-in procedure. I made an app for that, my friend, and it's a very cheap app. It's called the iTunes Rekordbox Collection Backup Tool, and that is exactly what you want. You say that you already have all the tracks on an external drive. Are those the tracks that you use in your Rekordbox collection? Are the tracks in your Rekordbox collection stored on an external drive? Can you answer that in the chat? Maden, Happy New Year. Good to see you, my friend. And Jan-Willem Groeneweg, good to see you too. Happy 2022 to you as well. I'm waiting for Alan Cross to answer me. All right. Then all you have to do is export the collection to XML on your existing Mac, which means you can just go right here, export collection to XML. Name it whatever you want, Rekordbox. Replace it. Then when you are on the... And then you take that XML, you put it on that external tool, you disconnect that external, and you walk to your new M1, and there you make sure, and that's the first step, and that's very important, that the M1 has access to the full drive. And let me show you, pull up my M1 computer again, because especially with By the way, Alan, you will see variations of what I'm telling you here in a moment in action, because we are going to do a shitload of stuff going back and forth between computers. So you will see more, but just in your particular instance, just put the Rekordbox XML on an external drive, and then go to your computer, go to the system preferences, go to the security and privacy preferences, go to the full disk access, then open your applications, find Rekordbox. And mind you that if you are using M1, you might can use 5.8.6. Everything older doesn't work, not reliably on M1. However, I strongly recommend that you go to Rekordbox 6, simply because that is more stable and better for M1s. 5.8.6 works kind of, but if you use controllers, stuff like that, you need to be on 6, the latest version of 6, in order to be compatible. Back to what I want to tell you, go to full disk access and lock it. And then just drag Rekordbox into the full disk access pane. This is important, my friends. This is really important for all your DJ software and for my apps, because if you don't do that, then you cannot access the drives on an external volume, period. The OS will block you, will give you all kinds of trouble. So all your DJ software, my tools, always need to be in the full disk access, and I prefer to be in the accessibility pane as well, because that speeds things up, but make sure that it is in the full disk access. Alan says, I want to have a copy of Rekordbox of 5.8, and then a copy of Rekordbox 6 to use on both Pioneer X2 and RX3. Forget about Rekordbox 5, my friend. Go to Rekordbox 6. Now, mind you, let me just show you what you need to do, because it is very, very simple. Let me get an external drive here. Here I've got one, which means I have to walk back and forth a little bit. You don't even need my tools. You can do this fully automatic. Here we've got Rekordbox. Let me give it some tracks inside. Playlist. Create new playlist. We call that the test playlist. I need to turn my library sync off, because otherwise you don't know what you're looking at. And let's put three tracks. Oh, hold on. My bad. To do that. Find my external drive first. There we have the external drive. Then we put... I'll just put... like this. Oh, that is like you have, Alan. You have external... You have your tracks on external drive. And you have... exactly like this, right? So I just have a collection with external drive. I go to export collection in XML format, and then let's do it directly to the Prutz drive, Rekordbox. It really doesn't matter what you call it, but I like to name it Rekordbox so you know what it's all about. So on this Prutz drive, I have my tracks and I have a Rekordbox XML. The latter is very important. Now I eject the Prutz drive and I'm going to walk to the Mac Mini, so hold on. This might take a second, because I have to walk through there. And I hope that there is a USB cable there. But probably there is a USB cable, because this is my testing machine. And this is one of the nice things about using external mic, as you see, because you can walk back and forth and still be able to be heard. So right now, we have the situation like Alan have. Is Dropbox done that again? Same story. I want to disable the cloud sync on my smaller, like this. Firewall bracket box. You can do this, by the way, for Rekordbox 5 and 6, but really, really, really stay away from Rekordbox 5 on an M1 machine. It is just not reliable enough, and you are on a dead end. All right. So here we have the Rekordbox on the M1 machine, you go to your preferences in Rekordbox, very important. You go to the advanced preferences, you go to the database, then you click browse. And then we are going to point the database to the Prutz drive, to the Rekordbox XML. That is the Rekordbox XML that I just exported, like this. Open. Now, if I look under the Rekordbox XML and you don't see Rekordbox XML in the column right here, and that is because it is disabled in the view. So let's enable it in the view. You see, I'm taking through all the steps, my friend. Can't make it any easier. And then, if you look on the playlist, you see already the playlist, your playlist. If you right-click and say import playlist, all playlists will be imported and all tracks are being imported with all the metadata. See it right there, you see the test title playlist, which was empty. All cues, all loops, etc. are all maintained. What is not maintained is the analysis data, and that is better too, because if you go from Rekordbox 5 to Rekordbox 6, you want tracks to be reanalyzed. So if you just select them, analyze tracks, you can turn BPM grid off because they already have a BPM and a grid. You only need to analyze them to create the graphical representation, the waveform, if you like. And you always have to enable something. So let's analyze for phrase. And that's it. Now I've got exactly my collection on the M1 computer, which originated from my other computer. For some reason that track is not picking up, but don't mind. So all you need to do, export the XML on your old computer, take it with your external drive to your new computer, import the XML data by right-clicking import playlist. Make sure that you are using the correct XML. You can double check that under the preferences, advanced imported library. So right here, this one is the one that you need to do. Then you can continue to work on your drives. No zip, no restore, nothing, just plain old, straightforward. I'm going to make this collection empty again, like this. Because I need it, and I'm going to enable my CloudSync again. Because in a moment, we are going to talk about the Rekordbox key tool with CloudSync. Let's see. Alan, if I use my original collection, which is actually stored over two external hard drives, is that an issue when doing your procedure? Not necessarily. I see that I have to block somebody on YouTube. Just did that. And let's add that person to the block list. Not really. However, you need to have both drives attached to the M1 if you want to use tracks. Otherwise, you have to do it differently. Like I said, I have made a tool which can concentrate spread out collection to one single external drive or to a Dropbox folder. And that makes things a lot easier because then you only have one. But it's basically the same thing that you do afterwards. What that tool does, it just collects all the tracks that are part of a collection and put them in one external drive. It's called the collection backup tool. Next week, I'm going to deep dive into the collection backup tool, because next week I have planned to show you guys how you can use Pioneer and Denon stuff with the same Dropbox collection without duplicate tracks. Yeah, then Alan, I really recommend you that you use the iTunes Rekordbox collection backup tool, which will do that, which will just basically take all the all the tracks and copy them all to one single external drive, and then you can import the XML information as I just showed you, and you will have everything on one external drive, which is also easier to back up. So then I would recommend you to use that. I think I can quickly show that too. Let me disable this one. Let me put my Prutz drive back. Close out. I need it in a moment. All right. Hold on, I'm going to walk to get my drive back. Then I will show you what how you can do this from multiple drives as well. But like I said, we are going to deep dive into the collection backup tool next week, simply because then we are going to have some fun with it. Back to my Rekordbox. And let me make the bus drive entirely empty. Also means that those tracks can no longer be found, so let's erase them. And then let's add some tracks from my internal drive. Then to make things a little bit interesting, let's create a new playlist, call that playlist server. And let's take some tracks from my file server, which is usually the thing where I store my stuff on. So now I have in my Rekordbox collection tracks from the server and tracks from my internal drive. Let's quickly analyze them. Why not? Trace just for grid like this. And then let's put a queue in a loop in the driver license so you can see that the queues are indeed maintained. Go there. And a 4-beat loop there. Alan, at this moment, I really don't care what you use. Hold on, folks. It's getting crowded now. I'm going to finish this showing the iTunes Rekordbox backup tool, and then we are going to. Now, what is important is, first of all, you need to export this again to Rekordbox XML, and if you just name it Rekordbox, then and input it in the documents folder, then my tools always will find it. Then we fire up the collection backup tool, and the one you are going to see is the one I'm developing right now. So might be a little bit unstable, but I think we are good to go with it. Let's give it a try. Okay, I want to go to the Prutz drive. I don't need to auto start the DQ, and you can see right here that the Rekordbox XML was automatically selected. Let me open the Prutz drive so you can see what is going on, because this is important to some of the guys who always say, yeah, but I want to maintain my storage structure. I want to maintain that too. So that's why I built this stuff. So if we go right here, a little bit bigger. There you can see that there is a startup drive. That is my startup computer. And there you see the Filmpjes account desktop. And there you see the Audio 5, which means my structure is maintained. Volumes, terabyte, that is the server, top 40 collection, top 40, 21. That is also maintained. Now, if I walk again. So what I have now, Alan, is all the tracks from all the various sources that I use are all on the Prutz drive. So my entire Rekordbox collection is on the Prutz drive. And I can share this drive with other Rekordbox DJ users and then temporarily use it. Or you can just import it. Let me show you both. So let me eject this and move back to the M1 computer. One out. And then make sure that we fire up Rekordbox already, because that always takes some time. And I can just quietly this. Okay, and this is on the M1. And make sure that I disable library sync again, because otherwise I get a cluttered library. I don't want that. Like this. Now, again, I go to my preferences. I go to the Rekordbox XML, and this time I have to point it to, again, the Prutz drive, Rekordbox track backup tool, and there you see Rekordbox XML. That Rekordbox XML contains all the tracks with the correct file paths. Now, if you look here, you see that I've both things there. Now, as I told you, queues and loops are maintained. So if I load a track right here, and this is the way, by the way, how you can share this drive with fellow DJs and just quickly access your tracks on that particular computer or on that particular drive. You just have access to your entire Rekordbox collection, including the queues, the loops, and everything else. And then, but you can also say, all right, I want to have this in my collection entirely. Let me delete that untitled playlist. Then you can say just import playlist. You will see that both playlists are there. And those are now part of my M1 computer. Mind you, you always need that Prutz drive connected to your computer in order for this to work. But this is the easiest way. If you have a scattered collection, collection backup tool is the way to go. Then it's just importing the XML information and you will be good. Let me this all out again. And then I can enable library sync again. Like that. And I can move this side again, because in a moment we are going to talk about what we are doing here. I need to make sure that my own Rekordbox is set up, because Alan, we are now going to take it to the next level. What I'm now going to do is I'm going to show you how the Rekordbox queue and key tool, that is my tool that works with mixing key and Rekordbox, works with Dropbox and CloudSync, which means everything that's going to happen is going to be in the cloud. And that's also the reason why I have my 3000 connected, because as you might know, you can now play direct from the cloud using a CDJ 3000. And I just wanted to demonstrate how that, hold on, I just want to demonstrate how all that stuff works. As you can see, this entire collection is empty. And also here, I'm going to enable my CloudSync again. Here we are. Everything is empty. Yep, everything is empty. And you can see by the little recycle thingy that it still is recycling. Oh, that's fine. All right, so we have two collections here. This is the M1. And the other one is my live collection on this particular computer. Now, let's give some tracks. Let's make, how do we call this? Mojave machine. On the Mojave computer, I put some tracks. And I'm going to analyze them. That is important. Tracks need to be analyzed for BPM and grid in order for the Rekordbox queue and key tool to work. Once that is done, I'm going to move everything to the cloud, and you do that by right-clicking and say, double check that my Dropbox, by the way, is empty. Yeah, it is empty. So you select them all and you say right-click, cloud library sync, upload tracks to Dropbox. The fact that you see that cloud, that closed cloud in front of it, means that those tracks are uploaded to the cloud. Now, if you look right ahead on the M1, you didn't see it because it was on the other screen, but then all the tracks are loaded there. So this is the M1 computer, this is the Mojave computer playlist, and I can just load tracks there. Isn't that swell? Now, the next step is I'm going to put some of those tracks in Mixed in Key, and I'm going to not put some of the tracks in Mixed in Key, and I do that on purpose because I want you to see the difference, and I want you to see how this all communicates with each other, which is the real powerful part of it all. Let's take all these tracks and put them into Mixed in Key. They were already, oh, there is a risk that everything is already analyzed in mixing key because those were in there already. But hey, we will see in a moment. Mind you, I'm not closing out anything. I even have Rekordbox open on the M1 computer. I'm simply going to hit mixing key and I'm going to fire up the Rekordbox queuing key tool. By the way, the update has been released yesterday. As always, it's free to all the licensed users. And the moment you start the app, you see the little exclamation mark at the gear symbol at the right-hand top corner of the opening screen, indicating there is an update. And if you click it, you can download that update. So the update is out, is live, and you can use it already for all of you who want to use it. I don't have to do anything here. I just say start conversion because everything is set the way I like it to be if it's default. And you will see that the Rekordbox is automatically closed. Now, mind you, also watch the Rekordbox agent, the little sync thingy. That is going to be closed as well. The ReCK takes care of everything. Rekordbox you see open right now is on the M1 computer, is on the remote computer. That is a linked computer. So that computer knows about the Rekordbox collection. And in a moment, I'm not going to do anything. You will see why that is. In a moment, the sync will start up on this computer, and then you can see on the remote computer, all the mixed key data, the ReCK data, is all being introduced there. And I think that is pretty impressive, but we can make it even better. There are some tracks, this track was not done, and that track is not found in the mixed key database, so it is not there. Now, why is this so important? This is important for all you folks who are on, for instance, Windows computer, and you want to use my tools. You want to use the Rekordbox queuing key tool. If you have a license for mixed in key Windows, I understood that it will also work as a license for Mac OS. So if you want to do this on Windows, let's imagine that my remote machine is a Windows machine. And let's create a new playlist here. And we call that playlist let's call it M1. And then let's give it a bunch of tracks. Too much because we're just writing here. By the way, I like to use the M1 for analysis. The analysis on M1 is so much faster than on Intel-based computers. I don't know why, because it's all going through Rosetta, but you can see it is instant. It is so fast. So I can highly recommend that. And then I can say, all right, put all those tracks in the cloud. And always, folks, if you use Dropbox, always use move. Don't, or copy. Don't you choose move. I know that if you choose move, you will save storage space. But if something goes wrong in your Dropbox account, then you lose everything. So I really like to copy, and I don't mind for duplicates. Like I said, next week I will deep dive into Dropbox, that you can put the Dropbox folder on a different volume, stuff like that. But please always use copy, not move, just to make sure that you don't lose your tracks. And you can see that right here, all the cloud symbols are there. And if I go right here to my home computer, you can see that all tracks are there too. They are just not uploaded yet. I don't know why it's not uploaded yet, because it looks like everything is synced up. So let's see. Load them. But we cannot load them. That is weird, because they should be on Dropbox already. Well, let's see if Dropbox is up to date, because that is weird. Haven't done a thing and it is not working again. Otherwise, I have to look into that. I've seen this behavior before, but on my Dropbox drive. Let's find her. Yeah, that looks like a Dropbox thing indeed. Or is it still syncing? I'm not sure if it's still. So let's hope that it has synced now. And otherwise, reboot of the Rekordbox should. Let's see. ATGR doesn't look right. This was done through. Very weird. No, it cannot show them in the Finder either, and this is done through Rekordbox itself, so not sure what is going on wrong here. Library sync is on. Toggling it on and off sometimes helps, but not for this matter because it cannot find the tracks. Curious, because that is coming straight from Rekordbox. None of my tools have heard them, and in the past this used to work, so I don't know what is going on here, folks, but I'm not intended to find out what. Let me see if Cresip is on the Dropbox drive. Let's see if it just did its work at all or not. Cresip, Dropbox. There's no Cresip file. That's that file called. Like Dropbox is not taking over, and that makes sense or not. Go in the Finder. My Dropbox. Oh, Dropbox is not running at all. Oh, my fault, folks. Sorry. I knew there was something weird going on because this should just work. But my Dropbox was off. I know why it was off, but now it's on. So, you can see even guys like me might have problems with stuff like this. And let me restart Rekordbox to make sure that it understands that Dropbox is now updated. Tracks. Don't you love it? There we are. They are slowly coming in. These two are not in yet. A moment, so if we reboot again, then everything should be synced up. There goes a very perfect, nice, quick demonstration of how this stuff works. See, now they are all synced up. So, problem was I didn't have Dropbox on, so it didn't sync up. My fault. So, what I did is I added tracks on the M1 on the remote computer. They are appearing even in my own computer right now, which means I can fire up the Rekordbox Q&Key tool, which most likely will tell me that those tracks were not analyzed, which is fine because I know why my Dropbox was off. That was the collection backup tool, which will turn it off as a precaution. Okay, here we are, and there we are, Rekordbox 6. And then you can see that everything is going to be closed again. And the Rekordbox agent will be closed in a moment. And by the way, while we are waiting, I have time to say hi to some people. Marcus Macau, good to see you, and happy 2022 to you as well, my friend. And Eddie Brome has the question, in Rekordbox 6, should my iTunes load method be framework or iTunes library XML? I personally prefer the library XML, Eddie, and that is because the library XML contains more information than the framework. But the framework might be easier, especially if you are on a music Mac, a Mac that uses music, the successor of iTunes, because on those Macs you have to manually export your XML data from iTunes. So that is the reason why I have to warn you for that. Marcus, I'm not sure about the Miami Music Week in March. The thing is that I'm not sure. I tried to reach out to the people who do the Miami Winter Music Conference, and I did some workshops there in the past. So I reached out to them. Are we still doing a Miami Winter Music Conference show? And I haven't had any reply at all. So I'm not sure what's going on. If you look at their website, it has not been updated since last year. And the only reason why I would go to Miami would be for having a booth at the Miami Winter Music Conference. And if that's not going on, then I won't be there. But you never know. And if you know somebody there, let them contact me. There you go. Happy 2022 to you, my friend. Good to see you and good to have you in the stream. All right, so I did run it. And I did run it, mind you, with tracks that were introduced on the other computer. And of course, it will tell me, hey, listen, there are some tracks that are not found in the MixD Key database. You can see those here. Those not found in the MixD Key database. And that is correct because those tracks were added on the other computer. So just let's MixD Key them. And then we run it again. And you will see that everything pops up. So let me run the Rekordbox Q key tool again. I still have to this my backup drive because it has many Rekordbox versions on it, and that's why this Rekordbox check is taking so long. It is checking all the versions on the backup drives, and I don't want that. Hey, this should be the last time that I need to run it. I had a great birthday, AJ Flow. Thank you very much. But that was even before Christmas. I feel very old with 55, but it's just more a number than that I can feel it myself. But thank you, my friend. Thank you for asking. There we go again, off to the races. And this time you can see that all the tracks, even in the M1 folder, now have cues from MixD Key. And that is of course the same on the M1 computer where they also have the keys from, or the cues and the keys from MixD Key. So that all makes it across. And just to top it off, just to show you how really nice this whole Pioneer DJ Dropbox CloudSync ecosystem is, because I am a fan, folks. I am really a fan of it. Let me go back to my screen first. Here we have USB. I have to give this USB. I can make this USB key to unlock the CloudSync on my 3000. And you do that as follows. If I go to, let me take it away first. You see a little off there. If I click off, then that USB is now a key to unlock CloudSync on the CDJ. So here we've got the drive. And if I change the view, there it is. And I insert USB like this. I hope that this comes out a little bit viewable. And then go to source. There you see the little cloud symbol at the top with Mixmaster G USB. I am not connected, but the moment I select this, ask me to log in. That means that all kind of stuff is going on right now. The CDJ will log into my CloudSync account and into my Dropbox account. If we go in there right now and we go to the playlists, there you see the playlist M1, and you see the playlist Mojave computer, and you can just load track, and that track will show up on my drive. Again, those tracks are not on that USB. Those are coming straight from the cloud. There is a known issue with color coding of the cues on CDJ 3000 for cloud tracks, and you see that in action right here. But all the information is there. All the tracks are there and you can just use them. And that is how I expanded the Rekordbox Queue and Key tool with new functionality for CloudSync and Dropbox use. Now, I know this is technical, this is wizardy, but if you just keep in mind, put everything on Dropbox and keep that in sync with each other, it will be good, and you can just use the Rekordbox Queue and Key tool and the final results will show up on CDJ3000, will show up on your Windows computer. Everything that is CloudSync connected and has the same Dropbox access will show those tracks and that information. I think that is really something powerful to see for this kind of stuff. And I think that this is going to be the future. I think that we are going to see lots and lots and lots and lots of cloud-enabled stuff coming out in the next years. So that's why this is kind of important. Those were the things that I wanted to discuss with you guys this show. If you got questions, just drop them in the chat and I'll be happy to have a look at them and to see if I can demonstrate it just like I did with Ellen a moment ago. Next week, we will have a Dropbox special, like I said. I will deep dive into what is Dropbox. I will just refresh your mind. What is Dropbox? How does it work? How do you use it as a DJ? And then I'm going to show you how you can use the same, the exact same Dropbox collection in both Pioneer DJ and Denon's ecosystem together without any duplicate tracks. So you don't need to have the tracks twice on your computer or on your Dropbox account. You can use the same tracks, use them on Denon, and you can use them on Pioneer. I got it all working already, but I wanted to put some slides before I dive into that, because otherwise it is really wizardy and I just want to make it as clear as possible. So that's the reason why we'll do the next week. I also expect to release an update to the Denon conversion utility, the collection backup tool, all the Denon related stuff that also fully enables this functionality. So if you use that stuff, stay tuned because there will be an update coming your way. Again, if you have questions, Jim, please drop them in the chat. Did you say that the new M16 with Monterey is not a good option with RB and your tools? Alan, not with my tools. It works fine with Rekordbox. In all fairness, it works fine with Rekordbox. But that particular PowerBook, so only the MacBook Pro 16-inch introduced last October, that is unable to run Apple scripts in Rosetta mode. And again, it is a bug. And again, I'm talking with Apple about fixing that. But right now, there is nothing I can do about it. Then tell you about it. Listen, if that is what you want to do, you have a problem because it won't fly. And I show at the beginning of this stream exactly why. And if you happen to have MacBook Pro 16-inch on Monterey 12.1, then you can try this yourself. You see, all right, this is an Apple problem. This is not Mixmaster G's problem. This is clearly an Apple problem. They need to fix that. So all I can do is warn, because I like to be totally open kimono. Others like to keep quiet about what is compatible and what is not. I always totally transparent about that. Right now, my tools don't run on that particular Mac model. It runs on everything else. And it runs on M1 and it runs on macOS 12.1, but just not that particular model. All right, my friends, that is the stream for this week, unless there is another question popping up in the next few seconds. Thank you all for watching. If you like what I'm doing, please give this stream the thumbs up and tell your DJ friends about the availability of this information, because I know I'm doing this for fun. I really enjoy doing this. But if you look at the numbers of people watching this stream, then you know it is not that much. And I don't want to have a lot of watchers, but I like to help a lot of people. So please spread the word that this information is available, that you can ask questions live, that I'm happy to have it. And please put the thumbs up under the video. See you all next week with the Denon/Pioneer Dropbox special. Mixmaster G.